Dear friends, agenda for this session is to have a discussion on the design optimization and realization using pure programmable gate array. I hope that you have carried out the previous exercises and understood about the design flow, which consists of specifications, then design entry by using VHDL Verilog, then functional simulation, synthesis, design implementation, and finally, whatever your FPGA programming. So at the higher level, we have discussed about the design flow, and the agenda for this session is how complex designs you people can design. So again, audience, as it is very basic level course, I have targeted undergraduate engineers as audience or beginners in the area of FPGA ASIC design. Then basic prerequisites are basic understanding or basic knowledge of digital logic design, basic understanding of VHDL and Verilog, and basic knowledge of complementary metal oxide semiconductor. And effectively, I will not speak much about RTL coding using Verilog or RTL coding using VHDL. For that, you can join another courses which I will float for the Verilog designs as well as VHDL designs. Again, those courses are very advanced courses on the VHDL designs and Verilog designs. For that, again, basic prerequisite will be basic understanding of digital logic design, basic understanding of VHDL and Verilog. So let us recall, whenever we spoken about the programmable logic or pure programmable gate array, then at that time, effectively, we thought that, okay, we can use that to design some sort of functionality. And as it is reconfigurable in nature, you can program that many times. Again, it depends on who is the vendor. So few FPGAs you can program only once, few FPGA vendor supports programming or reconfigurable arrays. Due to that, you can program that many times depending on the functional requirement. Now let us consider that I have a 4-bit processor and I need to implement 64 instructions. So at higher level, let us think that what we need to do or what is essential to understand. So effectively, I need to understand the functional specifications at the top level and effectively at the module level also, because a single person will not be able to implement whole processor. There will be team who can implement the processor, and depending on the experience level, you will get some module to design. Then you need to understand what are the inputs and outputs at the chip level, at the top level, as well as at the block level. So effectively, you need to understand inputs, outputs, interfaces, and all that. You need to understand the external interfaces, isn't it? Then you need to understand about the instruction set and timing. And by using the specifications, whenever architect will create architecture, micro architecture for that particular design, then at that time there will be some sort of gate count estimation. Depending on that, target device will be chosen or selected, and by using that target device, effectively you need to perform the synthesis or design implementation or whatever your block level implementation. So let us consider a 4-bit processor which is having arithmetic logical unit, then instruction decoding, bus interface logic, then serial input output logic, then few interrupt signals are there, interrupt acknowledgement as well as interrupt from the external environment. Then there will be some sort of internal memory which is required, which can be in the form of registers or to store the result. Then some status registers are required to store the information about parity or carry or any other status or overflow, you can say. Then I need to have a control logic which can control the operations or control the data transfer between memory, IO and processor. And I need some external IO interfaces. So effectively, suppose at higher level, I will not go into much more details of functionality of each and every block. Okay, so the idea is that, okay, suppose some complex design is given and already that design has been partitioned at the architecture or micro architecture level. Depending on that, gate count has been estimated, device target FPGA device has been selected, specifications are frozen prior to that. For the top level as well as at the module level, and then you are having chip as well as block level input outputs. So everything is now suppose ready, and you need to pick up some module or some module is allotted to you. Then at that time, how you can go for the design? So programmable logic, whenever we are using, that is pre-programmable gate array, then at that time, whatever this arithmetic logical unit is there, that is having multiple functionalities, isn't it? It can perform multiple arithmetic as well as logical operations, as well as there are other operations related with serial input output data, as well as there will be some additional other operations. Whenever interrupt occurs, then at that time, what this module what this processor effectively will do, or effectively what it does. There are some external input output interfaces which are required to communicate with external IO devices, and I need to have a serial IO, serial input output devices which are coupled with the serial IO module. So first point is that let us try to understand that whether it is low or moderate gate count design or complex design. Then at that time definitely there will be specifications, isn't it? So specifications for the low or moderate gate count design or small designs, I can say, there are limited specifications. So by understanding those specifications, it is possible for us to understand how that logic can be implemented at the fabric level. Or whenever I will try to write a Verilog code or VHDL code, then at that time I will try to understand that, okay, how I can go up, what should be my strategy whenever I am writing the RTL using VHDL or Verilog. But for complex design, it will be difficult to imagine in one go that how this logic can be realized on the FPGA fabric. So there are multiple blocks, there might be interdependability between the blocks, there are input output signals, input output pins for every block, at the same time top level interfaces for the top level module, isn't it, which can communicate with the external world. So it is not a job of engineer, isn't it? So effectively job of engineer is to understand the module functionality for which you need to realize the design, and then you need to have a strategy that, okay, how I can use a efficient VHDL or efficient Verilog constructs, synthesizable construct, to implement the design. So design architect or micro architect will do all the estimation as per as your gate counts are concerned, specifications, from the specifications, as well as what are the functionalities which are required for the design. So the role of engineer, is to understand the specification architecture and micro architecture, and then you need to code the you need to write RTL using either VHDL or Verilog, or even you can use nowadays system Verilog also, isn't it? So let us focus on one particular block. So processor at the top level, I can have consider that, okay, I have I need to interface serial input output devices with the processor. So I have pins which are for serial data, serial input data as well as serial output data. Then I can have interrupts. Then I can have a few address lines and few data lines, and I have a few control signals which are used to transfer the data to memory or IO, as well as which are used to generate some control signals to transfer the data while transferring data from processor to memory or IO devices, or from memory IO devices to the processor. So effectively at the higher level, at the architecture, micro architecture stage, for this type of designs, your design has been partitioned, and you have hardware software partitioning in place. So depending on that, particular module will be allotted to the design engineer or group of team members, and depending on that you can go ahead and design by understanding the interdependability between the modules, sorry, interdependability between the blocks. So effectively nowadays, if you consider the architecture of the modern FPGAs, then at that time lot many FPGAs from Xilinx as well as Altera, they are having processor cores. And effectively, as a designer, you need to understand about the IPs, intellectual properties, and functional and timing proven IP details, and then you need to integrate those IPs in particular design, isn't it? So effectively in the present scenario, it is nobody will say that, okay, you need to write some sort of RTL for the processor, or you need to validate some sort of processor by writing from scratch the RTL, isn't it? So you can use some sort of IP core depending on the requirement, or you can use some sort of processor, soft processor cores which are available on the particular FPGA fabric, and then you can configure that. So let us try to consider that simple arithmetic logical unit. Okay, so agenda is not already, I have given some exercise so that you can design arithmetic logical unit and then try to go for the performance improvement of the arithmetic logical unit. This area can consist of few arithmetic instructions and logical instructions. So you need to understand how many number of inputs and outputs are required for this ALU. Then how many number of instructions, how many arithmetic instructions are there, how many logical instructions are there, and total how many number of instructions this ALU need to perform. then you need to understand the funda of registered inputs and outputs, and you need to think now that why you need to have a registered inputs and registered outputs. What happens if I will drive some other module with combinational output only? Okay, whether it will be having impact on a timing, or whenever I will carry out the STA, then at that time what I need to consider? Okay, at the fabric level. Okay, that you need to imagine whenever you try to prepare a strategy to write the RTL code by using VHDL or Verilog. So effectively for this ALU 4-bit processor, I have two operands X and Y. And the size of this operand is 4-bit. Output is again 4-bit, or you can say output can be 5-bit including the status flag, which can be stored in the status register. So effectively output is 4-bit with if number is not fitted inside the 4-bit output, then at that time you need to incorporate one more status flag. Then I need to have a control inputs depending on the number of instructions. If I have 32 instructions, then at that time I need to have a 5-bit code. If I have 64 instructions, then at that time I need to have a 64 arithmetic logical instructions which are need to be realized by using ALU. Then at that time I need to have a 2:6, that is 6-bit. So this a simple logic, ALU with 4-bit operand X, Y, and control inputs are there. These control inputs will vary depending on the number of instructions this ALU need to perform. And at a time it will perform only one operation. Output is 4-bit, and you can add one more status flag with this if output doesn't fit in the 4-bit. So for the registered inputs and outputs, what are the requirements? So effectively I need to have some sort of block which can have a registered inputs, which can allow me to pass the registered input, isn't it? So I can have unregistered input or registered input. So effectively how these IO blocks are configured, okay, or how this IO block capabilities can be used for this particular registered input, registered output, that you need to think over the period of time. And then whenever you will be implementing by using Xilinx or Altera tools, then at that time you can understand in much more detail. But as far as at the higher level, your most of the designs or almost all the designs, they have the registered inputs and registered outputs. So for this ALU, if I have 32 instructions, okay, you can write the RTL code. Already I have sent you the exercise for the same, that you can implement the ALU by using either VHDL or Verilog. You can use the Verilog constructs as well as VHDL constructs. Effectively, it should perform only one operation at a time. And it should have a minimum area. Okay, these are the constraints at present. So you can find out after implementation whenever you perform the simulation and then go for the synthesis. Whenever functionality is matched, you are doing the synthesis. You can find out what are the FPGA resources which are used, how many logic blocks are used, how many lookup tables are used, how many registers are used, how many IO blocks are used, whether it requires a block RAM or not, whether it requires dedicated multiplier. If I have some multiplication instruction, whether automatically the multiplier resource will be used or no, whether there is any requirement of the DSP block. For the small design, I'm not using, effectively there will not be, with reference to whatever exercise which I have sent, there is no any need of the DSP blocks. So effectively at the fabric level, if you consider the ALU with 32 instructions, then for the target device, you can get the what is the IO count, that is IO block, how many number of IO blocks are used, then how many number of programmable logic blocks are used, among those programmable logic blocks, how many lookup tables are used, how many registers are used. So at the top level, you can imagine like this. Okay, I have this FPGA, consider this FPGA area, and it consists of many programmable logic blocks. So it may use few programmable logic blocks which are indicated by these square boxes. So effectively these blocks will be configured, and effectively the ALU, whenever you write the RTL, whenever you try to implement the design, that is by using translate map, place and route, then at that time, or translate and map, then at that time effectively these many configurable logic blocks or programmable logic blocks are used. Then it uses 4 IO blocks for operand X, for operand Y it uses 4 IO blocks, for 32 instructions, I have 5-bit instruction code or control signal, so 5 IO blocks are used, and then you have a result as a 4-bit output. I have not considered in this status of the flag. I consider that whatever your result is there, that is fitted in the 32-bit, it will fit in the 4-bit. So effectively there will be one more IO block which is for the status flag if number doesn't fit in the 4-bit. So this is the requirement, and there is a need of the routing resources. So you can have a switch matrix and programmable interconnect where this logic can realize the arithmetic logical unit, isn't it? Or you can say the it can realize every programmable logic block having lookup tables, that is LUTs, and by using those LUTs it can generate the combinational logic, or it can implement the instructions depending on the way in which you have written the RTL. If you write, I suggested that you can write the ALU code by using if then else statement or if else statement in Verilog, and then try to find out what is impact as far as area is concerned. Okay, how many programmable logic block this ALU uses, and you can again modify the RTL and write by using a case statement, and then by using that you try to find out how many programmable logic block it uses. Okay, again you can try out one thing, that if you don't have a registered inputs and registered output, effectively it is only simple combinational logic, then at that time I don't need to have a register from the IO block. So what is impact on the overall resources, that also you can find out. So effectively whenever this design is routed, then at that time there will be connection between multiple programmable logic block to realize the functionality of the arithmetic logical unit, isn't it? There will be connection between IO blocks and configurable logic blocks or programmable logic blocks, and to realize the functionality there will be again connections by using programmable interconnect and switch matrix in between multiple configurable logic blocks or programmable logic blocks. So effectively routing delays will be added. So you can carry out a very simple experiment. If I will try to sketch a long line on a paper, and then if I will try to break that long line in two parts, then at that time effectively what will happen is that length of the line will be reduced. Okay, but as far as my FPGA fabric is concerned, this long line might be having much more delay, isn't it? Okay, and it can be used for some sort of specific purpose. If I have a small length line or minimum length line, then effect of resistor capacitor, resistor of the wire and capacitor, that will be reduced. Effectively, time constant will reduce, and effectively that will reduce the routing delay. So tool algorithm effectively will take care whenever it will try to map the design, as well as it will try to route the design. So 4 IO blocks for X operand, 4 IO blocks for Y operand, then 5 IO blocks for the instruction, what you can say, instruction code or your control lines for 32-bit instructions, and then you have 4 blocks, 4 IO blocks for the result, or you can consider now 5 IO blocks for the result including the status flag. So effectively, if suppose I have IO blocks with reference to the previous slide, you can say if I have the IO blocks to realize the output, or it is configured on the right side of the in the right row of the FPGA, then at that time definitely there will be very huge routing delay, isn't it? If it is routed like this, tool will do the tool will take care of all this. If it is routed like this, then at that time what will happen is that effectively your routing delay will be minimized. So it depends on the intelligent tool or whatever your EDA tool algorithm, that how it is routing, and effectively it will be routed in such a way that it can use the resources in proper way, so that your design performance can be at the higher level. Then effectively, if we consider the resistor registered input register output, you will get a register to register path. So effectively, you need to understand about the STA, static timing analysis, and how to find out the maximum frequency for the design. So for that purpose, you can understand register to register path, that okay, I have some register clock is given, and it is synchronous design. Output of the register passes through some sort of combination logic, and it is driven to the D input of another flip-flop, where that another flip-flop is again driven by the clock input. So as it is synchronous design, I will get a register to register path. So for this ALU design with registered input as well as registered output, you will get the register to register path. So why you need to consider about the static timing analysis, and what is exactly happening, what exactly tool does whenever it carry out the static timing analysis. Definitely there will be constraints which are required, which need to be given to the EDA tool. So if you can go through the Xilinx or Altera literature as far as flow is concerned, as well as you can say the different steps to carry out in the implementation, you can get some information, you can get a lot of information about. So with this you can carry out some exercise. So consider the simple design which last week we have discussed about. Now this design is having 8-bit register 0, register 1, register 2, register 3, and it is having multiplexer, some counter structure, and 8-bit register from where output of that register is output 2, and output from multiplexer is output 1. So you need to find out how many different timing paths are there. So effectively you can say how many input to range paths are there, then how many register to register paths are there, how many register to output paths are there, how many combinational paths are there, or how many input output paths are there. So why registered inputs and outputs are recommended for any design, you can understand by using the simple terminology, that okay, that if I have registered to register registered input and registered output, then what happens exactly in the design. Effectively, it is if you go through some videos on the digital logic design and advanced digital logic design, I have explained the methodology how to find out the maximum operating frequency. So you can find out maximum operating frequency for the design. If now you consider that okay, I have two outputs, output 1, output 2. If output 1 passes through some combinational logic and register to generate output 3, then what is the impact on the frequency? Whether my frequency, I need to consider something different so that it can be useful for the next subsequent sessions. So you need to understand which are the timing parameters you need to consider to find out the maximum operating frequency. So effectively, most of the undergraduate engineers, they are familiar with the VSDL Verilog codes and all that. Okay, so what I thought is that okay, at the device level or at the design level, if some sessions will be delivered, then it can give some sort of good understanding for the undergraduate engineers also, that and their thoughts can be What I can say, they can get some additional thought as well whenever they will try to implement the design. And instead of only depending on the EDA tools and capabilities of the EDA tools, it is better that if you can have a habit that you can understand the specifications for the particular design or particular module, and then you try to understand the architecture, micro architecture for that. And then you, if you try to code the RTL, then at that time, effectively, that will give you much more better performance as compared to the strategy where you are directly starting with a Verilog or VHDL coding. So don't directly start with VHDL Verilog coding. Try to understand what is exactly, because it will infer some sort of hardware, isn't it? Or if you consider the FPGA, then at that time, particular resources will be used by the EDA tool depending on the vendor specific program, and effectively your input is very important for that. So effectively your input is nothing but your VHDL or Verilog file or Verilog RTL. So if you try to write the RTL by using efficient Verilog constructs or efficient VHDL constructs, definitely synthesizable constructs, then at that time you can get better performance for the design. And as far as performance improvement techniques are there, there are many performance improvement techniques which you can use at the RTL level. And in one session, it becomes very difficult for me to explain all the performance improvement techniques. But you can imagine like this, okay, I have the design which is having much more area, much more combinational path between between two registers. Then at that time, what I need to think, okay, how I can boost the performance of my design, how I can improve the speed of my design, isn't it? If I need multiple resources at a time, then at that time how I can go for the sharing of the resources. Okay, suppose now consider some design where multiplier is used many times, okay, and effectively whenever you try to perceive the design at the fabric level, or if you try to imagine the design after whenever you write the RTL code at the RTL code, at that time you try to imagine the design at the fabric level, then at that time effectively you can understand that, okay, I need to understand about the register to register paths. So depending on that, you can think about the code. So interpretation and correlation between what this FPGA, how this can be realized on the FPGA fabric and how I am writing the RTL. So effectively you are directing the tool for going for the better performance optimization. And there are other optimization techniques which are depending on the vendor specific EDA tool algorithms, as well as you can go through them by downloading the data sheets for the Xilinx and Altera FPGAs. So effectively, whenever you try to write the RTL, then at that time you can use, you can think about that, okay, this will be fitted on some sort of FPGA fabric, and I should have a goal that I should have minimum area, minimum FPGA resources. I should have the maximum operating frequency, or my design should meet the given constraints. And there are other low power techniques or power editors which are available to get the low power designs. Okay, so subsequently in next couple of sessions, what we'll do is that instead of limiting ourselves, or instead of thinking that okay, why instead of thinking that okay, we need to think about only small gate count, low gate count designs or moderate gate count designs, let us think about some sort of high density designs and then try to understand what are the issues. So effectively, if you see that okay, I have a design which consists of millions of logic gates or billions of logic gates, okay, so effectively whenever you will try to work in the industry, then at that time you will be exposed to such kind of designs, although you'll be designing some sort of module. So you need to consider that okay, my module is driven by some other module, and then if other module owner is giving me the combinational output, then at that time what is the repercussion as far as overall design whenever it is integrated, what will happen, okay, which timing parameters will be violated. Okay, so effectively whenever you try to write the code, then you will say okay, I need to have a registered input to registered output. That is first point. Then second point is that if I will try to design something without understanding the architecture of the FPGA, then at that time whether I will be missing something. Okay, I have FPGA which consists of DSP blocks, okay, and instead of understanding that okay, how many DSP blocks are there, or instead of understanding capabilities of the FPGA, if I will try to write the RTL, then definitely there will be whenever it will realize, it may or may not use the DSP block. Okay, so that that DSP block will not be configured or will not be used. So if we consider some sort of complex designs, then at that time we can understand about the what is exactly happening in the practical world. So that is the agenda. So with this you can carry out these two exercises, and then in the next subsequent sessions we'll discuss about the fire timing simulation and STA, which plays important role. So thank you for your time. So in the next session we'll discuss about the timing simulation and